Okay, so my idea about these talks was to talk about, in general, 360 and the cameras that we have right now, and how each camera fills in a particular niche in the market, and then how we can grow from starting to work with, let's say, an Insta360 and then grow to maybe a Z1, a DSLR. Because, at least for me, it's always into providing a higher quality product to your client. And focusing on the higher quality product for the client, that what actually gave me new clients. No, not focusing only on creating the image itself. And I started with Nikon D90 back in 2012, and now I have a full frame D850. Probably it's an overkill, but it produces sharp images. And it's like one of the biggest mall here in Toronto, like Square One. They hired us because of the image quality. So they looked at everyone in the area and said, "No, we want you because you have high resolution images." Now, myself, I'm using all the cameras. So I have an Pilot Era, the DSLR, a Z1, and an Insta360 ONE X. Now, each camera has its own features. Like the Insta360 is good on video, so I like that. And you can make a video, 360 video. That's the camera that I'm going to, and it's like I've used it for example, let me share my screen with you. I've used for last year, there was in Toronto, the Life Black Matter protest. So in this particular case, what I wanted to do is I want that the tour published on Google as fast as I could can do it, so I can send it to the media and media to take it and use it, and through the fact that the media will take my tour and use it as news, then I would later on get work just by this. So now the problem is, I've created this tour. Probably it was around, I don't know, in the morning around 10-ish, 12, and then by 2 or 3 p.m. the tour was already processed. So I got the video, I extracted all the frames. The frames had the GPS because it used my phone. And yeah, using Street Builder, and then created everything, published to Google, created a virtual tour with GoThrough. And then by 4 or 5, already sending this to the media. Now, my problem is that I don't have ties to the media, so wasn't picked up. It's just a guy like we have here in Toronto. We have a magazine, Blog Toronto. The guy said cool, but I'm not sure. Probably I don't have, like, he's the main guy. Probably he didn't forward this to anyway. So my idea was to get into the media and do something, be in the media with And I think you can do that in your area also. Like that will promote you and quickly. Yeah. So that's what I'm using the Insta360. Create the video and boom. Then I have the pilot one. Back then I didn't have the pilot one. Probably I would have used the pilot one. But what I like pilot one is for blue lines. So the blue lines, this is a really great camera. This is my street. I've been on this street. I've created up till now two blue lines. One is created with the in 2009. No, this is the one. Come on. So in 2019 with the Insta360, I had it on a tripod. And I was hiding around the cars. You can see me here. The quality is it's decent. So I would say the quality is decent. And then this summer we've got the Olympics. Yeah. So the IOC, the International Olympic Committee, contact us. Because they had a project for the Tokyo Olympics where they want to document the whole back end of the Olympics. Now, this project, and they actually talked with all the companies that are out there, like a virtual tours company, and they picked us because one of the tour maker software, you can download it. And it's basically I'm one of the only guys that own the company and actually shooting. So they had to deal only one guy. Anyway, so I bought the Pilot Hira. This was a test to see how it works. And yeah, like I really loved it because. And then again, I haven't used it as the camera is advertised. Yeah, like creating a video and then publish that video directly to Google. Myself, I'm a guy that like you can use it like that, like easy, but I love to dive in and do my own custom workflow. So in this case, I had installed an app. It's called a Clicker. Auto clicker app, and that shots one image. Yeah, you can see me here. Shots one image every 6 seconds. And shooting an image and shooting a video, the image will be always higher resolution than a video, because the video that you have to go to the compression of the video. There is some compression also in the image. But you have more control with an image. Again, like this would not be feasible, like walking on a street that where there are cars. And for that, yes, you would use a video. But in my case, in my scenario, like I had to walk. And for walking, I think shooting individual images is good. And the nice thing about it. Is it has GPS, it has heading, so it's just a matter of okay, you upload it and everything is there. You just click a button and go through auto connect, and everything is connected. So that's what I'm using the Pilot Hira. Now, the Z1, I love it, I just love it for vacation and small projects. For example, in the winter also I wanted to reach the media and I created using Tour Maker, I created a small game where this is my dog, this is my daughter, where you have to talk with a few people in here, and then there is a riddle, and you have to discover the riddle. Like, basically, you have to find the eggs. So this was around Easter. And you find the eggs, and then you find the result. Again, I wanted to reach media. Probably I have an issue with the media because I couldn't. It wasn't picked by media. But the thing is, if you insist enough, probably at some point you will get there.
Yeah, they'll pick up.
They will pick it. So I will try this again in the winter. No, yeah, this is my drone. So I have also a drone. And having a drone, I think it's very important in our field. Because for us, there are three basically major business types that we are working with. One is this year was schools, but previously is car dealerships and dentists. And for car dealerships, they always want like a panel from all up in the air. So having a panel up in the air and having a drone, it's really. And right now with the drone, with the Mini, you don't need to have a license because it's so light. You don't need to have a license. You don't need to call anything. You don't need to do exams. So having a Mini at least, yeah, is good. So this one plus another thing that I used. I've recently been my nephew, which lives in California, actually works for Apple Maps. And he designed on the iPhone, he designed the AR function. So whenever you open Apple Maps, in the AR, that's my nephew. But where is that? So I've been to his wedding. Okay, so I think this is on, yeah. So I've been to his wedding, and this is shot with Z1. This is me, and I have this very long pole, like it's 3 meter long, and besides the groom and the bride, I was probably the most popular guy at the wedding because I had this stick and I was poking everything, like I was everywhere with the camera, and everyone wanted to know what's with that camera. even the photographer at some point they came to me and asked me, like, what's that camera, like it's like it does great video, or like what's happening. Yeah, so this is like a wedding between Apple and Netflix. Like, yeah. So, and the DSLR, of course. And the DSLR, I'm using it for my paid, like the... Yeah, this is another project I did. We had some renovation at backyard, and I documented, like, okay, the 5th of May 2020, 6th, 26th, 14th, and this is this year, like everything was done. Now, this image was shot with the Pilot Hira in HDR mode. And I find that it's for outside, at least HDR mode is not very, very good. And also, if you notice here, I had an issue with the lens. When I bought the camera, I bought the camera secondhand. It has a scratch. So that was the result. Like, I fixed myself the scratch, and I have a video regarding how to fix a scratch on a lens. And I think it's pretty decent. Like, if you go to this tour, you won't see. Like, there is a barely faint somewhere here, I think. I don't know. But you don't see it anymore. Yeah, so the idea of this first talk is that whatever camera you have, you can use it for your business. And definitely the more camera that you have, the more use cases you'll find. Now, I think in the future talks, we're gonna talk about how to work with each particular camera. But yeah, this one is just like we went through all of them that at least I have right now. Yeah. And my point was that you always should strive to improve. Again, I've started with a D90, and in the beginning, that was like, okay, how do I make the nadir like the smaller? How do I increase the dynamic range? What do I do when there is a pot light and it's casting me a lens flare into my lens, or the sun is casting me a flare lens, and how to do all this, like how to deal with all this. And always it was a struggle for me to learn and improve, and little by little, okay, what's happening if I'm shooting with ISO 100? What happens with ISO 400? So all this, like little by little, you experiment and you find what works best. Now, for me, at least on this point, because I've shot so long with the DSLR, like I don't find the workflow for between shooting with the Z1 and the DSLR to be okay. I get more time shooting with Z1 than shooting with a DSLR. I don't find it, because in the case of Z1, so in the case of Z1, how do I, okay, stop presenting. So in the case of Z1, I have this dual RAW plugin, and it shots 9 images into one and creates one DNG file. And the nice thing is it takes it under 1 second. So those images from the wedding, I was like just handheld with the 9 DNG, and the images are decent even inside. But you have to take the DNG, open Camera Raw with Lightroom, and then you have to work on the DNG and increase the exposure, the dynamic range, all that, like the blacks, and the go down with the highlights. So you still have to do some stuff. So you still have to process the images. Now, if I shot with the DSLR, everything is like in batch mode for me. Like, okay, I'm just taking the images, drop them into Bridge, process the RAWs into JPEGs, infuse everything. Like, I'm just putting them, they're just starting some stuff and then just leaving. Yeah, it's gonna take a bit longer, but I'm not doing one by one. And then PT GUI, and I end up with having the picture and high quality images. Some cameras like Pilot Tira, it's just like, yeah, you don't use it. But even those, sometimes I love opening Topaz denoise, and you push the images through like the DSL, the Pilot Tira, you push them to Topaz denoise, and the images become even sharper, even crisper. So you find, you see, it before it was a bit more blurrier, and then it's now a bit more sharper. So again, whatever process you use, I think the time, if you want to have good quality images at the end, the time is leveling up, no matter what camera you're using. Yeah, so I think this is would be the first talk, but now if you have any questions, let me know.
Do you find you're using that Topaz? Like I've seen it, but I've never actually looked at using any of those software items.
Yeah, so the Olympics, that was like a really challenging project because, and actually I will be in Beijing in 3 months, no, 4 months. So the Olympic is like, okay, it's a fast moving process, project. Like I cannot, I would love to have the time shoot with my DSLR like in HDR mode, three brackets or five brackets, and then process everything. But that's not the reality. Like the reality is when you're there, you have basically 1 hour from when you're there to cover all the area before the athletes come in, and you cannot do anything. Like you cannot take your time. So in my case, for the inside, I've used the DSLR, and for the outside, I've used the Pilot Era. Now, what happened, and I didn't test it too much. I did actually a test in the first day. I was happy with the results, but then when I reached home, I realized, it's not the best I could have done. So basically, what happened, I was shooting way too fast. And in case of the D850, when I'm shooting, I have a touch screen, and I'm touching the screen, and that triggers the image. Now, because of time constraint, I could not shoot three images in a row. Yeah. So I was shooting raw in one image. And then I said, okay, I will take one image raw and then process to camera raw, do as much as I could do with one raw. But again, it's a documentation. Yeah? So the project is a documentation. It's not gonna be public ever. So it's more like, okay, documenting the whole space for the future Olympics. Because not everyone can come to Tokyo or to Beijing for what's happening at in Paris. Not everyone. So if they have this document, then they can train people on it. So the quality was not like one of the main points, but what I found is when I was shooting, I was introducing vibration. And I had some really blurry images. And the only solution that I've managed to a bit improve the was Topaz. So Topaz denoise, I think, or sharpen, I don't know which one I've used the most, but I used that, and then you had really a lot of motion blur. And using that, it improved. Like you can actually read what it was like on different things in there. So before you couldn't. So that was where I used Topaz. Plus, I've used Topaz for the Pilot Era. Also because that imp Topaz denoise, because that improved also the quality a bit. So for that project, because I had to be fast. So yeah, that's where I've used those applications, and I'm happy with that. And I will, for I don't know, $100 that Topaz denoise is, I think if you buy the whole package, I don't know, it's a bit less. But anyway, before like you use it, you sh they have a trial, so you can test it on your own images and see. Because initially I tested it on my Z1, and I couldn't find a really improvement. I bought, I think first time I bought the Topaz Enlarge. In my head, Topaz Enlarge was what I needed. Actually, it was Topaz Denoise. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to take a look at it again. I haven't really not look at it again. I'm going to take a look at, I think it was the Sharpen product.
Yeah.
For a job.
Okay. So. If no more questions, then we can wrap it up. Yeah, today for me it's a full day. I have to work on the Olympics. I still have the images to process there. It was a big job. Okay, so I'm really happy we got to get together and talk. And I hope you have learned something new today.
Well, I think I'll ask most of my questions like I've been doing for the last month or so online. Most of my issues are around the Insta360 and GPS missing frames. The latest update you did on your app, it didn't work again for me.
Okay, so we have a new release. I think it's 1.1.4.
Yeah, that's the one that you just put out last Wednesday. And it threw in another loop for me. It said that the number of frames extracted don't equal the number of GPS frames extracted. And of course, then it didn't map GPS. These are technical issues with the Insta360. So I was hoping to perhaps in your next videos go into other videos, because I use the 360 outdoors, like you say. The indoors, I'm using my DSLR. I've been doing that for the last 10 years. So DSLR, piece of cake. Using a DSLR outdoors, especially when you're on a 3 kilometer walk.
Yeah.
Way too slow.
Way too slow, yeah.
Yeah, because I typically take 6 shots times 3 to do a 360.
Okay.
And like you say, I use Lightroom, PT GUI to do all the workflow. So from a DSLR point of view, it's a piece of cake, but using a single shot video camera is where a lot of my problems are coming in.
Okay, so then probably, yeah, I think you've sent me some videos, no?
Yeah. I'm not sure if I'm logged in with my Google ID here or my personal one.
I have one of your videos in here. So I have you walking through a forest. I think this is this is your image.
I pretty much come to the conclusion the Insta360 is nothing but a toy. If you take a look at support from the company itself, it's pretty weak. An email that I was actually drafting for you to send to put things in perspective, if you take a look at the Insta360 video, the pre-processed video, there is something like 72,000 lines of EXIF info in the video.
Yeah.
And the processed stuff by their studio puts in 80 lines of exit info. That's it. They throw away virtually everything. So you can't even tie frames, individual frames, to a timestamp. They throw that information away.
Yeah.
Hey, I guess my big question is, I'm at the point now where I'm thinking of throwing away that camera. Which one should I replace it with?
For outside,
this is
the pilot, the lab panel E1EE. I think it's
E1E.
13. Yeah, so myself, I have the Pilot Era, but there is no difference between Pilot Era and La Panel. Now, what I love about La Panel is it's fast, and it has GPS and heading and auto leveling.
Okay.
But my issue was with auto leveling, at least in Tokyo, I leveled the camera once and then I just said, oh, okay, that's good enough. No, like actually you have to level the camera. Like it has a function in here and you have to level before you start the job. So before you start the job, you go find a level surface, you put the camera, re-level it, and then you start the job.
Right.
One downside of this camera is that it doesn't give you raw images. So it's just JPEGs. And what I found is at some point, like sometimes the camera might read an incorrect white balance, and then you don't know because you're not looking at the camera all the time. So you might
Right.
get an incorrect white balance, and then whatever you did from that point on is like a pinkish color.
Right.
And then you have to open the images and then try to fix as much as you can the colors, in Camera Raw or Lightroom. But again, it's a JPEG, so fixing the white balance at that point. Now, another thing is the camera doesn't deal very well with shadows. So it's gonna be like shadows will be really dark. One solution is you put it on exposure plus one. But again, if it's outside too sunny, too bright, you might get a bit of like not too sunny. Too sunny, I think, is okay. What I found is in Tokyo we had a cast day. But when I was in the Olympic Village, it was the sky was a big softbox, and because I put the camera on plus one, that light like made the sky really blown out. So probably I should have put the camera on that sky on a regular like normal exposure compensation. But if you have a bright sunny day, plus one, I think it's good. So there are those like fine details that you get them only after you use the product. But again, I don't think there is anything better right now for blue lines besides this camera, like at least in this price range, even the like people that are using the Insta Pro one or two, to me that's a big headache. You have to have so many cards, and then you have to. It's like if one card fails, and your whole project is like down the drain. Plus, you have to take all those images, process all the images into one. Like to me, I think it's a headache. The GPS is so-so. They don't have heading. Oh, it's way more expensive. And this one
How
is,
sensitive is the,
yeah.
I was going to say, how sensitive is the GPS on the one you were just mentioning?
It's pretty good. Like I loved it. The only thing is, and again, I've found after is you start the camera, you start shooting, and then you have to wait. Probably, let's say, 10, 15 seconds. So the camera gets the GPS, and then you start walking. Yeah, so in my case, I was just starting the camera, I've had my pole and then start walking, but those like first two or three images that I was shooting, they don't have a GPS because the camera didn't lock the GPS on. But again, like in my case, I'm not shooting video, I'm shooting intervals, like one image and then one image every six image every 6 seconds. So there, yeah. Again, like I find it's my share screen again. I haven't tested for inside, but again, this is HDR with I didn't like it. It's the HDR from Pilot Era, at least outside, looks like really, I don't know, not real. But this one I think I had to fix the color. But just you see in here I have the correct color. So the camera got the correct colors. And right after here, like you see, it's a bit bluish, it's good, the and then boom, everything is a bit yellowish. Yeah. So that's when the camera starts shooting a bit pinkish, and I had to fix the color. But look, the leveling is good, pretty good. I don't know. I think it's good. I really love the quality of it. And again, this is shot with and frankly, I haven't seen too many lens flares. I do have some lens flares in my Tokyo project, but is some. Oops, I jumped. But is in cases where the sun is at the edge of a building or something like that. So when you, that's when I found to have some flares. But besides that, I could be not too many. So again, like if you want to upscale your game, I think that's for now the best camera for Street View.
Okay, appreciate that.
So you see, it's even with exposure compensation plus one, the dark area is, it's a bit dark. Now imagine that I wouldn't have not had exposure compensation plus one, it would have been like even darker. So that's the only thing. Now, regarding blue lines and walking through a forest, it's not
Yeah, the
something.
talent.
It's like the Google needs, like when Google processes the blue lines, they need continuity between two frames. And if you pass through a bush, then there is not that continuity. And Google will fail the blue line. That's the issue I have with blue lines through parks and through forests. Like park,
Yeah, I've run into that, and I've sort of make adjustments. So, I mean, they want shots every 3 meters or so, but when I start running a situation like that, the shot will actually start coming more often. So there'll be more shots than what they really want. My biggest problem is GPS. I mean, with the Insta360, with the Insta360 GPS remote, I'm still getting plus or minus 15 feet
Yeah,
or
no.
more
The
on
GPS remote
negatives.
is not very good.
And I don't even think it's because of clutter, ground clutter. Because if I use something like my cell phone with AllTrails, for example, my cell phone GPS is tracking the GPS almost bang on where it's supposed to be, regardless of what the canopy is above my head. But unfortunately, I'm Android, so Android doesn't talk to Insta360.
Oh no.
No, apparently you need to use an Apple, an iOS phone for proper connectivity. And again, I'm not willing to spend $1,000 on a phone just so I can take some pictures.
Yeah, you can buy an you can buy a second hand iPhone and use that.
I've got an old, what is it, iPhone 5 downstairs that you can have.
Yeah, no, that's what I was saying. Like, probably if you go with an older iPhone and you can find probably for $200 or something like that used on Marketplace, then I don't know, that will fix. But yeah, I'm not sure. I cannot say that I've played too much with the GPS in Insta360. What I did, when I did a live Black Matter protest, I think I just shot pure video, that's it. And then automatically position everything. Like, not automatically, but then it go through the way it deals with when there is no GPS, we put everything in a line. So I just took a line and then bend it. Like in that particular in the case of that particular tour, there were like four line three lines or four lines. So I just banded the whole thing, right, to match the map. And that's how I did it faster. But again, it's streets and they are like, yeah, straight angles and
Pretty
stuff
quick,
like that.
yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so
It covers me off, thanks.
So again, if there are any other questions.
No, thanks for doing this. I almost need another IVRP seminar or whatever that thing was that we did in Quebec City,
Oh yeah.
just to find out what Google is doing. I have not been following up on all of their changes and whatnot. The blue line, I vaguely know what it is, but I have never figured out how to monetize it. And it would be almost valuable to have some kind of a seminar that explains all of the different changes and avenues that that Google has gone through. But
Sure, I
thank you
second
very
that one.
much.
Yeah, so just a bit of news. Like, I'm not sure if you seen, but Google is retiring the Google My Business program, and now they call it Google. I forgot, but one second, let me search my.
Business profile.
Business profile. So I've lots of people have asked me, okay, how it does this impact the Street View Publishing project? And I've shot an email to the product manager, Stafford, and asked him, and he said there is no impact.
Just a name change.
Yeah, it's a name changing, but then there is for the business is how they are managing their information. So before you had a dashboard, I think, and now they are moving to managing all that information directly from maps, if I understand correctly. So it's mostly on that side. But regarding our project, what I hope, because Google is always changing, yeah, so always they had the C inside, they took out the C inside, they had the thumbnail, they pushed the thumbnail for the C, see inside a bit further. And so with this change, maybe there are changes that will help the 360 world, I hope. I don't know. We'll see in the future. But for now, yeah, there is no change. Okay, yeah. Thank you for joining this live session, and we will stop it here. And I think we're gonna have another session on Friday. Saturday is not probably one of my best days to have these live sessions, because I have two kids, and we have to have to drive them around for extra school activities. Okay. So anyway,
well,
I will
look forward to your next one.
Yeah, I will send an email with when the next live session is and what we're gonna talk, and looking forward to see you then.
Right.
Thanks, Al.
You're welcome.
Have a good
Take
night.
Care.
Good day.
Day.
Yep.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye now.